BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome to Poets Pause. My name is Marilyn Klimcho. I'll be your host for this evening. I'd like to welcome my audience and invite you to attend First Thursday at the Goggle Works at 6 o'clock on August 3rd, where we were going to feature Jennifer Hetrick and Russell Copeland. And then I'd also like to invite you to another event on August 8th at Aladdin's restaurant in West Reading. It's called Second Tuesday, and it's basically an open mic where we all kind of gather around a table, share our poetry, and have good discussions. So the PSAs aside, let me introduce for this evening my poet, who is Alexandra Papoutsis. She's a junior at Albright College and pursuing a bachelor's degree in accounting. She was the 2014 Berks County Scholastic Poet Laureate. And I would tell you that out of a field of 47 entries that, and RAC runs this contest, she came in with the winning poetry. She's been a feature in Lancaster's 15th annual spoken word play and a writer for her school's literary magazine, I would assume both at Wilson when you were a student there and now at Albright. She has a deep love of writing and of spoken word, and she hopes to publish someday. I'd like to open the interview with Alexandra with a quote from her favorite poet, who is Anis Mosgani. And her favorite lines are, "I want my words and actions to be the qualifications of my love, to make tangible the passions in my heart for the world and the people in it." Now, I would tell the audience that part of what I do as host is to make a point of familiarizing myself with these poets that she's discovered on her own. And one of the things that struck me about Anis Mosgani was that apparently at one point he was in a venue, an event, and he was in the middle of doing a performance, and the electricity went out, and he kept going and absolutely won the hearts of the whole audience. And so anyway, just to let you know, these are the kinds of people who are inspiring our guest. So, Alexandra, I'm hoping you will share some of your poetry with us.
Well, yes, I'd love to. And going along with that, she mentioned one of my favorite poets. I'd like to talk about, real quick, two lines that inspire me with everything I write. The first line would be, "Here's to those who inspire us and don't even know it." That is the basis for most of my poetry. And then another quote I really love is, "There isn't a person you wouldn't love if you could read their story." So with that being said, I'd like to get into my poems. The first one is called "This is the Greek Culture." I recently traveled to Greece with the National Hellenic Society with 61 other Greek Americans, and we got to do a cultural immersion. So here's the poem. Sister, we come from a people that live by the water. The mountains are daringly beautiful and cascade into the sky to tower over everyone. But they are not monstrous. They are scaled to perfection with low towering plants to show off the beauty and shape of the mountain. The houses are clustered and scattered and never overbearing. They all have little orange rooftops. The water extends into forever and is flat and gorgeous, and in the distance you can still see the next mountain. Pictures will never describe what I am trying to explain. By the beach we can swim out far, lay in the sand and stare at the stars. Part of me is forever there, never caring if we make it back. The food is rich, Everything is fresh, and the man you buy your fruits from at the market will throw in extra cherries because he is generous. When we get coffee, instead of saying, I am tired, we say, I need to see you. I miss you. This is the Greek culture, and it would be nothing without the people. I am lucky that everyone I have met, everything I have seen, can be accredited to the bonds I made when testing out the language on my tongue. It can be certified by the hugs I shared on balconies while telling stories that will exist a lifetime, because none of us will ever forget them. This is everything I have been blessed to see. The people are beautiful and strong. They carry distinct features of their heritage between dark hair and smiles. And I cannot see where I have gone wrong. I have sacrificed sleep here. I've forgotten 5 o'clock dinners. I have learned that if something doesn't get done, maybe it wasn't meant to get done. I am looking at the airplane as it is flying over the Atlantic Ocean, and my experience will only start making sense after. Where does Greece belong? There are many ways I could answer that, but truly the only important answer is that Greece belongs in my heart. One day I will be reunited with all the people I love, and it will be beautiful.
Oh my, I have the wrong heritage. I want to be Greek too.
Thank you. Yes, I absolutely loved my time there. The next one I will be reading you is a part of a This Is How series. Recently, I've been writing a series of poems that start out with This Is How. This particular one is called This Is How You Say Hello. This is how you say hello. You muster up the courage, you get up, stand up, blood boiling, you move waves through your teeth, and your teeth speak oceans. You let go of the idea of holding back as you stare into the eyes of the beast. You are the hunter, and the beast is hungry, crazy. The beast is gentle, but you don't know that till you're shaking its hand. You move back and forth between motion and shaking as you stand on the edge of what could be. You let go of the fear of embarrassment. You let go of the fact that the person you're staring at might let you down. You go back and forth between doubt, want, but at the end of the day, you are brave. And you are very afraid, and you know you will leap. You know you will fall. You must find sunshine in his smile, her smile, their smile. Put the shadows behind you, take a deep breath, and say, thank you.
Now, I have to pause here.
Yes.
And ask you, how much experience have you had with spoken word, with memorizing and then mm-hmm. delivering your poetry?
Well, I definitely have a decent amount of experience, especially through the spoken word play. I felt like I had to memorize my poems to speak to the audience. However, it does come naturally. I do feel like most of the times I read over my poems so many times that the words just stay in my head. So it makes it a little bit easier to read.
See, now my difficulty is I will start to memorize a poem and then I will go like, wait a minute, let me edit that word. And so I cannot get through memorizing a piece without editing. So I'm in like awe of your abilities.
Well, thank you very much. I don't have all my poems memorized, but I do have a few. Interestingly enough, the next one is called This Is How You Say Goodbye. So you get to see the flip side of that. This is how you say goodbye. This is how you crumble. You steal movement from his lips when he says goodbye. You glance up from the pools that are sitting in your eyes, and there are pools in his eyes too, but you take notice that they are not in his heart. You kiss his temples one last time, knowing that you'll never hold a world in between your fingertips ever again. You scribble yourself out over the white noise that is suddenly deafening. You find peace in one last goodbye. You hold your hands against your ribs, aware that at any moment you could fall apart. And then he walks away. Then she walks away. Then they're walking away. This is how it ends. Silence. At first, the world was so loud. Then it wasn't. You feel dizzy, like nothing in your life has ever been sturdy before, but you got used to the feeling this is how you crumble. You sit in your room and never really come out, counting down the days that have gone by since you felt alive. You crumble. Like cookies in the cookie jar, you are sadness and leftover dreams under all the people you now watch. You search for familiarity in each passing face, but never really quite find it. This is how you say goodbye. You never really do.
Very good.
Thank you. To go along with that theme, I have two more that are also connected. This next one is called This Is How You Fall Apart. You are a leaf. You sit on a branch perched high for all to see in the springtime. You are beautiful and strong. Most days it's like nothing can faze you. You are happy at everything you see. At a small bird taking flight, at a person singing a song, it all makes you happy. It's like you're feeding off of everyone else's happiness and becoming high off of it. You are high on life. But then things start getting tough. Remember how I said you were a leaf perched high for all to see? Well, the catch is, it doesn't last long. Autumn comes, and like a collapsing star, you grow from yellow to orange, and then to bright red, and then you fall apart. Then you sit and look at life from the ground. Rock bottom, perhaps. And rock bottom isn't too great. You might get lucky, and for 1 second each day, the sun might hit the spot you're sitting on, and you might feel something special, something of that happiness that you once knew when you were high on life, high on someone else, but the sun leaves, and you wonder if you had ever felt anything at all. This is how you fall apart, darling leaf. You become quiet. You become wordless. At one point, you were filled to the brim with life and ideas, and then you weren't. It no longer mattered what you were filled with, because words didn't matter for anything you still had to say. And you now just kind of watch people walk away from the weight of your pushing. You would think that falling apart was a tornado, but it wasn't exactly. It was destroying everything from the inside out, popping pills to forget how you felt, crying silently to yourself on a Tuesday. Falling apart was disastrous, horrendous, the opposite of beautiful. It was pain. I fell apart so easy, I didn't think I could build myself back up. My voice screams for me, but I do not understand what could make her so sad.
Tell us a bit about the teachers who have influenced you, because I hear some very mature language in here about, you know, let me just describe this. I don't want to sound insulting, but, you know, when you're young, you're very passionate. When you get older, you get a little, your poetry gets a little grayer around the temples. So I'm hearing some very mature material coming from you. So tell us about the teachers that you had.
Well, I will tell you of two of my high school teachers. The first would be Allison Hilton at Wilson High School. Allison Genova, I'm sorry. She is wonderful. She helped with the poetry club that we had. It was only me and three other students, but we were able to craft some really good moments and memories writing together. Mm-hmm. She was the first person, and then the second person would be Michelle Cambardella, who is a retiree from Wilson as well. She taught me to, like, she started a thing called liquid pens. So she would give us a sentence, and we would have to write for 2 minutes straight just everything that came to our head.
Good. I've seen those exercises, and I want to say it's Goldberg, and I don't remember her first name, who invented that, and you know, you had to keep your pen moving.
Yes.
Keep talking.
And she fostered the act of being mindful when you're in the classroom and when you're writing, and it truly brought like more of a serenity to my writing, I felt, because in the beginning, I felt like a lot of the time I was writing mostly about myself when I first started writing poetry. And then she kind of taught me to look at the world. And although I do tend to use the personal I in most of my poems, I am pulling pieces from different people I know into my poems. And it really makes me feel whole, like I'm able to include the individual and everyone together.
Yeah, and I know I was an art student at one point in my life, and I remember having to sit down and draw a building on a hillside. And I was drawing the building, and then I reached a point where I felt I was drawing the hill behind the building, and then I felt I was drawing the world that the hill was sitting upon behind, you know, and it just got a little, and I imagine that you have that same experience, that you're drawing, you're writing about all those other things that are in there that are behind that facade of that whatever it is you're trying to describe.
Exactly. I definitely agree with that imagery.
Yeah. That's very powerful when that happens. I hope my audience gets that experience.
Yes.
Okay, share some more poems.
And like I said, the last one from the series is called This Is How You Build Yourself Back Up.
Ooh.
It wasn't easy. Let me tell you, if falling apart took seconds, building myself back up took years. It took more time than I was at first willing to give up. It felt like I was at war for years, and I'm only now coming home. I was a soldier with my pack strung along my back, walking 50 miles home in the dirt because all I wanted to do was see my wife smile again. But it was worth it. In between all the internal chaos, I found myself again. I was young, figuring out what life really meant to me after losing myself. I wasn't the same, but that was the best part. I was something new. Something wise. I wasn't letting the pain of my past rip me apart. I was using it to fuel everything I wanted to do. I was incredibly selfish and oftentimes standoffish, but I had to be to create the new me, the me I could be proud of. Call that selfishness, but I see it as a dedication to loving my life. I found a therapist. She talks me through the things I am scared to say out loud. I once compared myself to a bag of potatoes, but she told me to think of it as a bag of strawberries. Sounds better, doesn't it? Slowly, she taught me to rewire my brain into being healthy. I couldn't keep bringing myself down when all I really had was myself to rely on. So building yourself back up is tough. It takes time and a lot of effort, but it is so possible. Brick by brick, step by step, you can recover. You think small efforts have no impact? Tell that to a ripple in the pond. It seems so small at first, but it travels miles to get to the center. I want to be that ripple. I want to make a change. I am not perfect yet, but I am building.
Very good. You mentioned that you had a poetry group in high school.
Yes.
Have you successfully found a poetry group or a writer's group to work with in college?
Not successfully. However, funny thing is, me and two of the other students ended up attending the same college. I try to keep in contact with them every now and then, and I'll say, hey, let's share a poem here. Let's meet up at the library and do something. It doesn't happen often, but it does happen occasionally. I also have a pen pal, Amanda Reitz. I was with her in the spoken word play. We both write to each other on occasion, and we like to share some of our poetry. We've also done a couple of collaborations through text message as well. So,
you know, my experience is that as a writer, you don't really develop until you get into a community of fellow writers, and you're sharing your work with them, and you're getting their feedback. I think that's incredibly important. I would point out there is a writer's group that meets every Saturday in the Goggle Works in room 413. That's the Genealogical Society's offices. They have a library there, and they meet from 10 o'clock until noon. So if anyone in our audience cares to join us, and they really review all kinds of material, not just poetry, but short story, novels, letters to the editor, if you are so inclined. Really good writer's group from noon until, and or from 10 until noon every Saturday. So I invite people to come. Would you share some more poetry with us?
Yes.
Thanks.
This next poem is called Sleep Talking. I wrote this because a friend told me that I sleep talk too much.
Well.
According to psychology, there are 5 stages of sleep, 1, 2, 3, 4, and REM. 5 very important, very crucial stages. Sleep talking is only possible in stages 3 or 4 because the body is paralyzed in REM. I could also tell you that the heart beats faster in REM, that it accelerates, like it's racing. But I am not a scientist, and I do not think that way. I imagine that instead, while I sleep talk, my mind, body, spirit, and soul battle it out for who is right. They pester me. Who am I? What am I becoming? And some days, I don't like the path that they are on. On days such as those, I know if I scream out loud, the voices in my head will gently remind me that I can't. Some days, I don't even recognize the sound of their voices, quite possibly the voices of others. Sometimes I drift through the carnage in my head, complex streets, never knowing if the light is red or green. Some days my body can hardly tell the difference, so instead of deciphering it, it gave up. But after many days of sitting inside my room, my mind, the dust settled. After overload upon overload of ideas and pressure and things I still do not speak of, one voice remained. I found myself laying in the dirt of my catastrophe, and although the voice in my head remains, it's telling me now that it's time to grow. Like a little flower or a towering building, I can restructure my mind, I can get better again. And even though most days it feels like I'm building a concave shack on 5th Street, I must remind myself that this is a temple. Mind, body, spirit, soul, I am a temple. I can shimmy from ropes and swing from the chandeliers. This is me at the heart of this temple, the me I've been searching for all along.
Very good. I see we're coming down towards the end of the program. We've got about 3 minutes or less. Do you have something that you would like to, a couple of poems that you'd like to wind up with?
Yes, I do. Here's a short one I have called December. December. You started crying. Snow was spilling from the clouds over our rooftop, piling fast and falling over. I could only feel the sky shaking. Your voice cracked. Mine did, too. I kept throwing the snow back up, shoving it back into the sky, back to whatever dark place it had come from. How shapeless I felt to hold something in my hand so temporary that it could only melt.
Very good. It's been a real pleasure to have you. If you have one or two more short ones, because I think we've got... Let me just check with our cameraman. We've got 2 minutes left,
right.
So we'll try to put in as much of your poetry as we can.
All right, so here's one I have called Butterfly. Have you ever loved someone so much that the thought of the thing you must do, the thing of the thing you must do, scares you rightly and justly so? Sometimes being in love requires whispering. It requires patience in trying times of virtue, in loud thoughts but quiet details. Sometimes it requires a hand-holding that can steady a gentle creature. It even requires a spilling, an opening of a dam so great that water tumbles forward and breaks through all the atmospheric pressure that holds your beloved back from saying all that is on his or her mind. Sometimes beloved is much shyer than you. It is your duty to get beloved to metamorph into butterfly, into wild butterfly with courageous colors on naked wings. Have you ever loved someone so much that you would do anything to wait for them to fly back, even after they have already left?
Very good. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
And thank you to the audience for joining us this evening. We've been listening to the poetry of Alexandra Papoutsis, who is a junior at Albright College and pursuing a degree in accounting, and was our 2014 Berks County Scholastic Poet Laureate. And I think we're probably closing down. So thank you very much.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.